it is a great pleasure to introduce Lucy Steets, who is a senior research fellow for After All at Central St. Martins, University of the Arts, London. She manages the exhibition histories strand of After All's research and publishing. And it is because of this series of publications, talks, and events organized and conceptualized by After All that, in particular, the term exhibition histories, but also material, teaching material, research material, has been made available through their wonderful work. Lucy Steets holds a PhD in cultural history from Goldsmiths College, and she also gained curatorial experience and years working at the Amalfini in Bristol. Her recent books include The Curatorial Conundrum, What to Study, What to Research, What to Practice, co-edited with Paul O'Neill and Mick Wilson, who is here today as well, or was here all week, at least. And the MIT Press 2016 at the exhibition for the Documents of Contemporary Art series, Whitechapel Gallery. So welcome, Lucy, and thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrea. It's just been a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Sophie, for a immaculate organization and technical support for my presentation. And Sarah, thank you for starting us off so thoughtfully and generously. I'm going to read. I hope it's not too impenetrable after the spoken presentation that Sarah gave us. Is that better? Can you hear me now? The background shot here shows the work known as an exhibit being installed in 1957. Here we see it being constructed for the first time at the Hatton Gallery in Newcastle in the north of England, before it was remade in London a couple of months later. Most visible is Victor Parsons. Right in the centre, one of the two artists responsible. He was closely associated at the time with British constructionism, a post-war strand of constructivism which sought a 1950s synthesis of abstract painting, sculpture and architecture. In the centre, but less visible, is the other artist responsible, Richard Hamilton, who was already extolling the contrasting virtues of pop art as focused on figurative US contemporary culture rather than the European abstract tradition. The third person who is key to an exhibit, although he's not visible here, was the British writer Lawrence Alloway. Filling the gallery space, an exhibit was constructed from Perspex sheets, some translucent and some opaque, some black, some white, some colored. As Alloway instructed in the accompanying catalogue, quote, the visitor is asked to look neither for separate works of art nor for symbols, but to inhabit, for the duration of the game presented, a real environment. He continues, the meaning of an exhibit is now dependent on the decisions of visitors. It is a game, a maze, a ceremony to be completed by public participation. End quote. Something similar is inscribed in summary form on the preview card printed for an exhibit's opening in London in the summer of 1957. Here we read that an exhibit is a game, an artwork, and an environment to be played, viewed, populated. In sum, we might say it was a playfully rethought exhibition. The particular element of this rethinking that I want to explore with you today, which I don't believe is yet attractive discussion, is also highlighted on this preview card, where we learn that at 6 p.m. on the opening night, George Brown sang a calypso introducing visitors to time exhibit. As you may know, the calypso musical tradition was developed in Trinidad in the West Indies while under British colonial subjugation. Closely associated with carnival, calypso lyrics were always topical. Composed especially for the occasion, they offered satirical commentary on aspects or events of everyday life. As described by Stuart Hall, quote, the music has a driving, springy, forward impel, rolling two-beat, adaptable to the rhythmic movement of the road march, end quote. In other words, the calypsonian's job was to get you moving as part of the carnival procession, while beguiling you with deadpan entertainment in which comedy carries a bite. Transposed to London in the 1950s, the subject matter of calypsos migrated with the singer-songwriters, and newfound life in the so-called mother country in Britain generated fresh material to examine in verse, as did the political moves towards decolonization back home and across Africa. The poised and playful revelry of calypso and its compulsion to pacing movement must have made it ideal for the inauguration of an exhibit, with its visitors coaxed and called to step through the maze presented. I'm now going to screen some footage from an exhibit from 1957, while playing your calypso recorded by George Brown a couple of years earlier. To be clear, the original film is silent, and no recording was made of the calypso that Brown was asked to sing on the show's opening night in London. So it's Brown's own work I'm going to conjoin with the exhibition now. I'm going to play one particular song by him, titled Calypso B, together with the footage of an exhibit, in a bid to inflect our understanding of the show today. And I'm going to repeat this experiment towards the end of my talk, but please catch what you can from the lyrics as you hear them now.
Boys, they know how to play, but that music is not for me.
underscore the humor of this calypso, hopefully without killing it off, we might note that George Brown was far from conservative when it came to music. In using the calypso genre to posit bebop jazz as a monstrosity, he reflects on and plays with contrasting music trends in London at the time. Indeed, he was not strictly a calypsonian since he left Trinidad without the specific training. Instead, he was an admiring interpreter of the genre, while simultaneously mixing closely with the jazz set who teases in this song. Listening to his music now seems to open up art historical debates as concerns British practice of the 1950s. The schism between calypso from Trinidad on the one hand and bebop jazz from the US on the other echoes other formalist and geopolitical cultural debates, if not standoffs at the time. And here I would lead you back to an exhibit as a playful victory for abstract constructivism rooted in Europe over pop figuration leaning to the US. I'm going to pause the film here, but I'll come back to it again at the end, also repeating the calypso we've just heard. As you can see here, an exhibit is the primary focus of a Brooklyn After All's exhibition history series, which I co-edited with Elena Creeper, whom we invited to author the core essay in the publication. With this latest title in the series, we explore the relationship between exhibitions and design and the participatory impetus in 1950s Britain as relevant to various exhibition trends for art today. Here are the 8 books of the exhibition history series to date, with the upcoming title on anti-shows in a Moscow apartment in the mid-1980s due out later this year. And just to say, I've worked more or less closely in all these books, and I'll be happy to answer any specific questions either in the discussion now or at any other point today. While all the books look very similar from their covers, and all are multivocal, uniting several authors, some writing now and some at the time under consideration, all the books in the series are different from each other, since they adapt to the theme under consideration and respond to the exhibition or exhibition's plural edition. Writing about historical shows of art makes particular demands upon prose, and for this book series we've commissioned different curators and art historians, artists and theorists to take up the challenge. We've also varied our approach to presenting the exhibitions visually through image sequencing and narration. In the After All book that takes an exhibit as its major case study, we start off by sticking to our own established norms. In other words, we produce installation and progress shots within the page grids inherited from the design of previous books in this exhibition history series. And we annotate the images, as is our custom, in order to give information regarding what's visible or adding detail about things that are not in shot, but are likely to have influenced the visitor experience. So to give an example, here's one double page spread from the main picture section of our book. The text here tells you, for instance, the names of the two men up the ladder, while noting both as teaching colleagues of Passmore and Hamilton in the local art department at King's College, Newcastle, which is the institutional home of this gallery, the Hackney Gallery. On the previous page in the book is explained that visitors entered and exited the gallery from a set of glass doors, which connected to the college art department. Actually, in the footage that we've just watched, at the very beginning, you can see these glass doors. But my point for now is just to highlight the sort of information that we add to installation and progress shots like these in our book. Then, after a run of such shots presented in this fashion, we break with the norm established by previous books in the exhibition history series, and we switch to full nude images. So that shots of an exhibit, once it's completed and in action, extend right to the edges of the pages and carry no words of orientation or explication. Given that the theme of our book is the intersection of exhibition making and design and participation, it was important to us to somehow respond in kind. We aim to invite readers to thumb their way through images of the show, engaging in a particularly physical way, ideally echoing, however remotely, what the exhibition offered in its actual event. Of course, I'm not trying to suggest this is a particularly radical design move, just keen to illustrate how we flex our own formats responsibly, given the particular exhibition that we're looking at. Frankly, it was Richard Hamilton who transposed an exhibit most brilliantly into paper form. form, in the form and in the catalogue produced in accompaniment. He opted not to bind pages, but to print and fold ingeniously. And securing plasticized paper, care of sponsorship from the largest manufacturer in Britain at the time, known to Imperial Chemical Industries, the plasticization acronym in that person. Hamilton produced the perfect vehicle for Alloway's drafted information instructions for visitors to an exhibit. These are the instructions I've already quoted to you. And of course, by comparison with this remarkable catalogue, our own more recent undertaking undoubtedly has a more documentary flavour, of course. I want to turn now, albeit selectively, to other bids to retell the exhibition histories of our exhibit. This is the most recent recreation of the show in London. It was produced 3 years ago by the Institute of Contemporary Arts, or ICA, which is the same institution that hosted an exhibit in 1957, directly after its installation at the Hatton Gallery in Newcastle. The 2014 remake of the show was not staged in the same building as the London original of 1957 because the ICA shifted its location in the 1960s. And the only thing I've got time to note about this recreation right now is that the broader curatorial context was a solo show for Richard Hamilton, with a different installation by the same artist in the gallery below, which inevitably marginalises the crucially collaborative role in an exhibit played by Passmore and Alloway. Here's how the ICA gave historical context to their recreation, which we could critique, but instead let's move across Mayfair in London to reach the 1950s location of the ICA, where an exhibit took place, which is now home to an expensively fashionable clothing store known as Dover Street Market. This other building was the site for extended institutional celebration in 2014, with the ICA adding graphic elements into the shop in order to flag their history of exhibition making at the site up until 1968. So here we are on the road at night, looking into the shop, into Dover Street Market, and it's labelled as such on the right-hand window. I can barely read it, but it's on the house-shaped, it says Dover Street Market. Through the left-hand window, we see a homage to an exhibit, with wall-to-floor photographs of the 1957 artwork turned exhibition, as originally installed on the floor above, together with red suspended perspex sheet that echoes the installation materially, though here it bears lettering that tells us the title of the ICA within the shop. So this is this half is the homage to an exhibit. These further shots show in greater detail the window display space given over to the ICA for their institutional celebration, highlighting in fact that the an exhibit elements, so that's the photograph in the perspex, are actually somewhat lost within other enlarged and staged ICA memorabilia and photographs of other ICA shows. And here's one glimpse of the rest of the shop, where further materials from the ICA archives are airbrushed, expanded, and reprinted for display behind clothes on sale. The big question for me here is, what do we gain from the history referenced? What urgency in the present is inflected and formulated? And I guess I mostly see a marketing opportunity for the retailers who are invited to capitalize on art in the selling of clothes. The ICA simultaneously markets their history in search of sponsors, perhaps, while missing the opportunity to reflect critically on and learn from their past activities. There have been numerous museological takes upon an exhibit over the years, dating back to 1961 in the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam for a show of kinetic and participatory art that moved on to Moderna Museet in Stockholm and the Louisiana near Copenhagen. The comparisons between the recreations in various eras and in different geopolitical locations are often striking. But given limited time, I want to turn briefly instead to a televisual restaging, which Richard Hamilton was personally responsible for in 1997, so 40 years after the original exhibition. This TV broadcast was made, the TV broadcast made use of the film footage of an exhibit that Hamilton shot at the Hatton Gallery in 1957, which I've already shown you. In addition, the artist colour-tinted elements of the black and white footage, as you can see here. He also added an intense soundtrack of distorted music, which offers an abstract, mesmeric, and disturbing but compelling audio accompaniment. But I'm not going to screen that work now. This is partly because it's very much a work of Richard Hamilton and abandons the collaborative and participatory aspects of Hamilton's work. And it is partly because it was intended for a TV screen in a domestic setting, which we're far from here today. And of course, it's a 1997 project which needs analysis with regard to its own time and context, which would take us into a whole presentation. So instead, I want to return to Hamilton's untouched footage of an exhibit and watch it again with George Brown's contemporaneous Calypso overlaid once more. This time, I want us to imagine that the minds and bodies invited into and implicated in the show in question are our own. Hamilton's camera work captures some reflections, most clearly his own, but no one is fully present, leaving a space that we are left to occupy. My hunch is that Brown's Calypso helps to lure us into this space, to channel our passage back to the 1950s installation, while helping us to understand the relevance of that past era when considering Britain and the wider geopolitical situation now. In his contribution to the afterall book on an exhibit, Owen Hatherley is of course right when he argues that an exhibit cannot be extricated from its particular mid-century moment in British history. But he also argues convincingly that the lessons of that history now lie in the productive early reality and attendant glamour of social democracy in post-war Britain, given the ensuing social evisceration in the country during the 1980s and 1990s. And here I'd extend his own powerful term, that of social evisceration, to our shared neoliberal present. In the same afterall book, Martin Beck, writes this. An exhibit is built on a double bind between Cartesian logic, or the control of the perspex grid, on the one hand, and corporeal sociality, or our collective participatory engagement, on the other. The result is a social abstraction, if one can think such a thing, that undoes the purity of modern geometry as it is exhibiting it, that undoes the viewer's individuality as it produces it. I find myself seduced by the sheer modernist beauty of Hamilton's footage of an exhibit, but it is through overlaying contemporaneous music, and specifically George Brown's song Calypso B, while reflecting on the Trinidadian immigrant experience in London of the 1950s, that I personally feel connected to the original exhibition now. To echo Martin Beck's analysis, it is through this music that I experience the work's corporeal sociality, its undoing of modernist purity, and its undoing of the individuality of viewing. When I wrote my introduction to the afterbook and an exhibit, I think I missed the cross-cultural significance of Hamilton, Passmore, and Alloway asking Brown to be a contributor to an exhibit on its opening night. It was playful, certainly, but it also marked the international or transnational inclusiveness of the participatory urge, of the participation actively invited in 1957. And it is in this spirit that I want to repeat the conjoining of building music that we shared earlier, before concluding with some words that will lead us elsewhere.
This modern music's got me confused. To tell your friends I'm quite unenthused. This modern music's got me confused. To tell your friends I'm quite unenthused. I like the wee hunk of the great Kung Basie, but can't make head nor tail of this Dizzy Gillespie with his boo-ba-ba-da. Be abba do la, beep, bleep, bleep, oo, bleep, oo, bleep, oo, bleep, oo, bleep, jam, chill, ya, ba. Oom, papa, dear, oom, ha, ha. Dizzy Gillespie is the creator of this new style, and go with Charlie Barker, Coleman, Hawkins, Howard, Majeef. They all indulge in this monstrosity. They take a major seventh and a flatted ninth. To pull your coos and a half a pint, then poop off a da. Be abba do la, beep, bleep, 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 b paupers you see around, they all converse in a special tongue. Uliaku and Iliada, one means hello, the other ta-ta. They call a man a cat and a girl a chick, and they up to all kinds of shady tricks with their oop-a-ba-da. Yabba-doola, beep-bleep-blee, oop-de-oop-de, oop-de, oop-de, jump-de-le-ba, oop-a-ba-dee-le, oop-a-a. In conclusion, I must now say, the beeper boys, they know how to play. But that music is not for me, so take it back, Mr. Gillespie. You'd better take it back to 52nd Street with your high-speed riffs and staccato beats and your oop-a-ba-da. Be-a-ba-do-la, beep-bleep-blee, oop-de-oop-de-oop-de-oop-de-jam-ye-ye-ba, oop-a-ba-dee-le.
George Brown dedicated to Calypso, Freedom for Africa, to Kwame Nkrumah, who led Gold Coast to independence and became Ghana's first prime minister and president. Several thousand copies of Brown's Calypso were apparently made and shipped to West Africa, but no recordings have been found, so I can't tell you that now. Trinidad and Tobago won self-governance in 1958 and independence from the United Kingdom in 1962. In 1966, George Brown played the role of Christ in a passion play or theatre performance titled The Dark Disciple, which was staged in Dakar, Senegal, in the august context of the first worldwide festival of black arts. The contemporary art exhibition staged within this context, called Tendencies and Confrontations, and organised by artist Eva Nidier, is the subject of an essay in the next issue of After All Journey. And in the same issue, the festival at large is brought into a wide-ranging discussion prompted by Chimiringa's recent exhibition and radio project in London a couple of years ago. Here, in commissioning these texts for publication, we begin to test what it would mean to do justice to the vast project of the Dakar Festival of 1966 and to the ensuing decade of related Pan-African events under the banner of exhibition. And that's everything I've got to say, but we can leave the film on.
Thank you very much, Lucy. It was really wonderful to see the Sarah's paper, to come back to this question, what is picked up, when and how do we populate these proposals as we could maybe understand exhibitions. Are there any questions?
Just out of clarification, the second the incarnation that you were talking about, that's this Richard Hamilton staged that, so the first and the second, or?
It's Richard Hamilton's footage that we're looking at now. He shot this footage at the Hatton Gallery. The first iteration of the exhibition was in the Hatton Gallery in Newcastle. This footage was shot by Hamilton there. In 1997, he got the footage out for the very first time and turned it into a 5-minute, 10-minute broadcast for television. It was commissioned by a TV producer to respond to a series of things called his TV sculptures. So Hamilton personally revisited his own footage, he coloured it, he tinted it, and he added his own soundtrack. But that was a specific commission, that was his own artwork in response to Andy's exhibit. So he was doing exhibition history, still his own work, but it was very much his own authored version of that history.
But it also, the idea of it being presented for television mm-hmm. opens up another, just the idea of the artwork as the exhibition, the televised exhibition, which I think also is interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. And the big question for me is always, as publics, who does this reach through the television? The slightly disappointing thing is we found that it was screened at midnight or something. It's one of those classic, you know, everyone's going to watch it, but of course, they put it on at any time, and many people are going to catch it. So it probably is still only the art lovers we've talked about that caught it. You know, it really wasn't after 10 o'clock news or whatever. You know, most people were interested in watching.
I have a question about George Bailey. Because you said you played that soundtrack is from 2 years prior to the exhibition. So what happened to the music that was in the exhibition? And was it the same?
Well, his name has an E at the end. So I've only shown it to you in the preview card that's an arrow, so I just feel as a historical pedant I want you to know his name has an E at the end. He was given a calypso to sing. The lyrics were given to him. There was script. I don't know if it was by Hamilton or Alloway. We found, Victoria Walsh found the script of the lyrics in Hamilton's archive. They very much echo the language of the show that Alloway contributes in the catalogue, the Foldat catalogue. So it's all about navigating the maze and how you're supposed to approach it as an artwork. So that is turned into lyrics for song. So George Brown was not, he didn't like the words. He was given the words. I assume he wrote the music. There was a brief moment in the 50s when calypsos were recorded for TV broadcast, and they were often written by Bernard Levin. So George Brown sang, was used to being given lyrics. He actually complained that they were often written terribly and had no understanding of how a calypso was supposed to function musically. But that, he then performed it live. So the only document we have of that calypso are the lyrics. There was no recording made, he didn't cut a disc. So it doesn't, we don't have that music, we don't have his voice in it, so I can't bring that back.
And was it only at the
RCA?
Or did they also do it at Hatton Garden?
A Calypso trio was mentioned at the Hatton Gallery, but we don't have their names, and I don't know the Calypso scene in Newcastle in the same way. I'd be very interested to learn more about it.
So I just thought it was interesting in terms of what the objects of exhibition histories are, like what gets saved and what gets used later on, and how what is included in the exhibition. So I was curious about its status within the exhibition, both as a kind of musical performance and the lyrics. But you're saying that the lyrics were archived by Hamilton. And it was not...
I'm not sure what archived, they were kept by him. They have since been archived.
And was it mentioned in that catalogue, the Foldat catalogue?
No, it's only on the preview card. I haven't read all the press coverage recently, so I'm not sure if commentators picked up on it. But if they did, they didn't say as the analysis that of any note. But it's just, it's classic. You've got one archive document, there's a line that says Calypso, we have a name, and from that you can piece together. There's very little knowledge of what actually, who made the connection. I've done quite a bit of research in Calypso in the 50s, and there's various things. There's the Calypso Festival in Soho in 57, where George Brown is a judge, Calypso writing contest. So this is all happening in a very small part of London. I'm sure all these things are overlapping. There's a Calypso ball that night. Did Hamilton and Alloway go? Who knows? I can't recreate the sort of exactly how it all came together. But there's enough threads that, for it to be realistic, suggest that this was more than just a random music accompaniment, that it was deliberately chosen as a musical form to lure people in.
Any other questions?
Total technophile. He loved recording equipment and he found the installation ravishing. He said his words ravishing. He recorded it for posterity. He then just shoved it in reels and in his house And then when asked to make something for television, I thought, actually, I can use this. So it wasn't made for television.
No, no, that's not awesome. Okay. I was not there.
Yeah.
The original footage wasn't made for television, yeah.
So Jerry Shum's TV Guide is a really important example from the 60s when both art and exhibition making being rethought. And certainly we have touched on that when we looked at Lucy Lepard's numbers shows, because she gave a room to screening those land art, so she kind of she puts back into the gallery the land art film that Jerry Shum shot and compiled and produced for television. We haven't got current plans to. We've got the next couple of books commissioned, and neither one looks at television as such. But it might be interesting for you, if you're interested in that forum, is. There was a series of films. Hamilton's film from 97 was a TV sculpture. There were several other TV sculptures. I haven't seen them. I have no idea if they're any good. But it was actually Sam Hodgkin, Howard Hodgkin's TV producer in the 90s, that wanted to himself think about art and the relationship with TV. So he doesn't do it as a curator or an artist. He does it as a TV producer. And he commissioned these four programs, one of which is Richard Hamilton's. I think Damien Hirst does one. So it doesn't have to be, what's interesting to me, I guess, is that it doesn't have to be an artist initiative to put art on the telly. It could come from it within TV culture. And then what's the status of it? That it could be the impetus, it's sort of curator, because it's a TV producer. Just to flag then, the book that comes out next year, so after we look at the Moscow apartment shows, we'll look at a performance festival kind of. Think of a better way of describing it, that takes place in Chiang Mai in the mid-1990s. So that's one example, just a flag, where it's not an exhibition, there isn't a museum, there isn't a Kunsthalle, there are live performances and social installations that take place in Chiang Mai under the banner of the Chiang Mai Social Inspiration. So as a series, we certainly are interested in complicating the format of the exhibition or insisting that there are myriad forms.
Thank you.
Interested by this musical standoff between George Brown, Summer and Dizzy Gillespie, as he explains it in the Calypso. And you know, if we think about Calypso within the context of how it's usually used within Carnival as a sort of Bactinian form of address, political address, bodily address, earthly upwards address. And we listen to his words and how he's saying that, you know, the bebop is not for him, and he's explaining somehow why it's not for him, and he's addressing the fact that actually it's the abstraction of the language which is not for him. You know, the way he talks about booba, babooba, and, you know, the very specifically mentions that. You know, here we have a standoff between, you know, the corporeality of the calypso and the emptiness, the lack of body within, you know, a modernist jazz, a bebop jazz. So I'm wondering, that standoff, that musical standoff, you've asked us very specifically to listen to the music, which is what I was trying to do, and I was asking myself why you wanted us to do that as we were watching the film. Now here, let's think about the film. What is the film doing? Richard Hamilton is presenting us a film which is completely empty and completely silent. There is no bodily presence there at all. So I see a contradiction there, and I'm wondering what you know about that. You know, what do you know about the process? You know, was the calypso simply commandeered as a, you know, decorative, seductive way of bringing the people into an exhibition that was meant to be participatory and full of bodies? Or, you know, was there something more significant? And why did that translate into Hamilton's subsequent film?
Thank you. I don't think it would just be simple to get them to view a people. I think that was quite sophisticated intent. The bringing of people into the space was absolutely vital to make it be what it was supposed to be. I think Hamilton's film is disembodied because that was his particular take on it. He loved the exploring with a camera, the sort of ravishing, as he describes it, abstraction. So that's his personal engagement with it. What we see is a projection of his vision of that work. But that's not how it was intended to be experienced in 57. It's not how I suggest we should experience it now. I precisely by the music in order to re-embody it. And for instance, with the music of a back, so we are implicated in it. But I didn't really think through the jazz as abstract and not, and Calypso as more embodied. So that then is the opposite in a way, because the victory, the formal victory in gallery terms is for the absolute, it's for abstraction. But also, I mean, it's not, Calypso migrates, it transforms in London, it ceases to be associated with carnival, it's a different thing in 1950s London. And it's a lot of Calypso's from the time of critiquing the social environment that Trinidadians find in the mother country that's supposed to be welcoming them in. So it's not as simple as the sort of traditional 19th century. It's not the pure Calypso, if you're going to find it, that is written about in the 19th century, has been written about and academicized. It's its own thing in London. And for instance, he says, when he's translating the abstract, I think it's more about translation. He says, Iyaku is hello, and he quotes the other one as ta-ta, ta-ta. I mean, I don't even know if people know that ta-ta is farewell in British colloquial language. So there's abstraction on all sides. It's more, transcultural, the complications and richnesses of that, rather than we don't like bebop because it's too abstract. And just to say again, he's absolutely friends with, he's spent hours talking philosophy with Charlie Park in the Marseille Festival. It's a very knowing critique of abstraction.
Before I hand over to Mattia, I also have one quick remark maybe. It's, to me, it also shows a historical understanding of documentation of exhibitions, and also then, furthermore, of a particular understanding of the exhibition and how to document it. Because when I worked at the Secession, the artist organization in Yemen, and I was their anniversary documentation of the 100 years of the Secession, and at the same time had the pleasure to have access to the archive, I thought, like, all I would have picked is not shown in the book, but is in the archive. And exactly maybe nowadays we would do the book, 180 degrees the other way around. And I think that is what is interesting, just to see like how this changes over time.
One more thing, just occurs to me, Kevin Lottering, who's written about an exhibit for October recently, and you write really beautifully from Hamilton's perspective about the sort of technocratic, futuristic side of an exhibit, the sort of depopulated, technological vision that it represents. So I think our project is to sort of repopulate it and say what's futuristic about the community that convenes, it convened then and should inspire you.
Yeah, sorry, I'm being greedy and asking another question. But just looking at that list of titles, and obviously knowing how important the After All books have been for so many interested in exhibition histories, I wondered if you could talk a little bit about how you select which exhibition to use Beatrice's term to valorize through this book.
We're quite wary of the landmark trope and the risk of asserting some sort of canon. So it's always done in conversation. If we're looking at something that feels very well known, we try to complicate that by juxtaposing it with something that's much less well known. But the simple answer to your question is through a committee of series editors located around the world and through public events. So if we start to think, for instance, the Chiang Mai social installation book I mentioned, we convened a three-day conference in Melbourne recently to gather people to discuss the significance or not, or complementary examples around that, to discuss what the theme of that book might be. So in conversation.
I just had a question. I was just wondering, I hope it's not too pedantic, but I was wondering if through the books also you could understand the kind of debate around also an exhibit also happening in the art historical field, let's say. So if it is considered, yeah, because you were saying that a lot of the time is addressed as an Hamilton project also because of the afterlife probably of the exhibition, but also how the three of them were thinking this event as an installation or an exhibition or a work of art itself, because it's also, it's quite interesting the way in which it's related to the exhibition culture at large, let's say more in the way in which exhibitions were produced in the 30s and 40s, also in other countries. So I was wondering if the book has also addressed that definition.
It's oddly neglected within conventional art history, obviously, but it could entirely be seen as a installation art before installation art gets discussed and be written about art historically. We didn't take on that task because we wanted to demonstrate a commitment to art in these public moments and deal with it not as a an object to be preserved and restaged, but as something that talks in its time and talks to us now. So we didn't commission anything that did art history to it, so I mean. But we certainly, in Elena's essay, she very closely maps it to the exhibition, history of exhibition design, specifically for Italian trade fairs. And so the sort of broader cultural picture is brought in rather than art history as such. It's more exhibition or design history that the book foregrounds, to be honest.
Back this way.
I think you answered some of my questions right now, actually. So I was just thinking of the difficulty of asserting an exhibition like that, thinking about an exhibition 50 years later, and thinking about what kind of impact it had then, you know, also how you work with, how you choose the kind of way to re-perform, in a way, an exhibition today. In that there are so many different aspects. You can talk about the futuristic, and that's supposed to pick up a really interesting theme, and then to think about that today, but I could also imagine, right, what, which has been brought up a little bit by Katya's question here, you know, what kind of bodies were invited into this space, today, for example, we might look at that exhibition and think it looks a lot like kind of retail architecture. But that's not, that might have been an element in a different way earlier also, for example, the relation to high modernist architecture, the most kind of exclusive part of design at that time also in the 50s and so on. So I guess you asked it a little bit now, I was just wondering how you choose or how to find the ways of looking at an exhibition and then kind of re-performing it. If you might say again.
Yeah, you actually make me think of the exhibition that's at Kunsthalle also at the moment, which in one of the two venues there, which is displaying the archive of Scandinavian Situationist International. The exhibition design in the present moment for staging that archive is a labyrinth, and this directly reflects the moment in late 50s when the Situationists were in conversation with Stedelijk about staging a labyrinth in the exhibition space. So this is I'm sneaking this in because it's suddenly reminded me that I didn't want to get stuck too much in the British context. But I don't think of it as a high retail thing. I think it very much as a backdrop for social conversation. So it's not closed to being presented. It's absolutely about the conversations that might happen in the space or the aesthetic debate that might happen in the space. In terms of who invited it in, I guess my big question, the reason I have done some poking around about literally who found George Brown and brought it in, is, I mean, did he bring the Trinidadian community into the gallery space, or was he just the entertainer? I don't know that. I mean, I would be fascinated to know whether that happened in the 50s moment. Because there was a trend at the time, for instance, Oxford and Cambridge balls invited Calypso singers to come entertain, because it So I don't know, there's the risk that was there, but we don't have to presume that. It might have been a very interesting meeting point.
Just on that, because the idea of having someone like play music at an opening wouldn't be unusual in this context. But what's interesting, and I'm wondering if this is, I haven't read this book, Lucy, so sorry if I'm reading something that's in there, but that the idea of having a dress and that the music is anticipating its own critique from a local audience, but more from, you know, the person, the audience who enters and is like, well, what is this art about? So that kind of that's where the music becomes a stand-in for the criticism that the art makers are anticipating their own audience might have in relation to quote unquote modern art. Mm-hmm. Or is that?
I don't know
that something.
I don't know my mind about the intentionality, whether
right.
they had that in mind or not. But I think it is interesting to see it in that way now. I don't know if they were seeking to implode modernity in the act of commissioning Calypso. But I don't really mind if they won't, because I can still see that there now, and that for me is important.
I would say that we. To say thank you again to Lucy. Thank you for this wonderful presentation.